Merci, Monsieur le Président, et juste pour ne pas vous interrompre tout à l'heure, je voulais respectueusement présenter mes excuses à la Chambre. Je ne serai pas là lundi et mardi prochain devant me rendre au Liban dans le cadre de mes fonctions au tribunal du Liban. Donc lundi et mardi prochain, ce sera maître Kersavut qui sera au banc de la défense. Je vous remercie, M. le Président.
ជូនទៅលោកស្រីចក្រមដើម្បីមានការសាក់សួរព័ត៌មានជាក់លាក់អំពីដំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាអំពីការប៉ុនប៉ងនៃការដាក់ស្នើសុំក៏ដូចជាមេធាវីដំណាងឲ្យដើមដឹងរដ្ឋនេះដើម្បីមានមូលដ្ឋានពិចារណាសម្រេចនៅបន្ទាប់ពីសហនការនេះទៅសូមអញ្ជើញលោកស្រីចក្រម
Thank you, Mr. President. The co-prosecutors indicated a wish to make a brief submission, and the chamber is ready to hear that submission now.
Thank you, Your Honour. Your Honour, the submission is basically in relation to the manner and conduct of the questioning. This morning, Mr. President, you granted the civil party the opportunity not to question the witness in the time slot provided, but go straight to the accused and question the accused. As Your Honour is aware, under Rule 91,
And Rule 90,
the basic rules in relation to the questioning of the accused are that the accused is questioned first in the trial, which he has done, and given evidence, and then the witnesses follow. And certainly the prosecution are not in a position to say that the accused should not be questioned by the parties as matters arise with the witnesses. But what we would say in relation to the general obligation to protect victim and witnesses under Rule 29, where it states that the trial chamber should take into account the needs of the victims and witnesses. Generally, we would submit that it's not the best method to allow the accused to be questioned and giving evidence in the middle of the witness's testimony. So, for example, as what happened today, we had the civil parties questioning the accused. The accused was disputing the testimony of the witness, and that was done prior to the witness finishing his evidence. The effect of that, and I think we all saw the effect of that, is that it's quite intimidating to a witness to be challenged directly prior to you finishing your questioning. And the sum total effect of that is that the questioners that follow, the other civil parties, and perhaps even the defence, they are left with the witness that has been undermined by the accused before he's fully finished his testimony. And then, obviously, that leaves in the mind of the witness that there's less trust in what he has to say, and there is less ability for him to be able to testify confidently and comfortably. Now, the prosecution, Your Honours, are not saying that the witness, of course, shouldn't be challenged, and he should be challenged where appropriate. But the challenging by the accused or the questioning of the accused should be the after the witness has fully testified, so that he's not intimidated by challenges that are made by the accused. Another matter that we would just like to raise is that we would submit that observations of the accused...
Excuse me, Mr. Smith, would you just slow down a little, because I think it's a bit difficult for translation to keep up with you. Thank you.
I apologise for that.
The
second point, Your Honours, is in relation to when the accused makes observations of the witness's testimony. We would submit that those observations should be made after the defence counsel has questioned the witness. And the reason why we state that is that we submit that it's important that the witness testifies in a regulated, methodical manner, and all the parties, the counsel, the defence counsel and the civil parties, are quite aware of how we should do that. The accused hasn't really or isn't really bound by those rules and procedures, and I would submit it's quite unregulated, so that by the time he's questioned by the defence, there's a slight undermining of his slight undermining of his confidence in giving the testimony. So we would submit that the questioning by the parties of the accused be done once the defence counsel have finished, and secondly, the observations of the accused being made after the defence counsel has finished his questions, in order to make the environment in which this witness testifies be as comfortable and accommodating for him to get that testimony out. As Your Honours is aware, it's very, very difficult for these witnesses to come to court 30 years later, and they come to court with mixed feelings, which is quite understandable, and I think it's important that we create an atmosphere that encourages them to talk so that Your Honours can get to the truth of the matter in this case. That's all the submissions I have.
Yes, thank you. Now, is there any comment on that submission from the civil parties? It would be extremely helpful if perhaps one of the civil party lawyers could make the response on behalf of all. Mr. Jacquin?
Monsieur le Président, Madame la Présidente, je me permets de répondre à la mesure où l'observation de Monsieur le Procureur fait suite aux questions que j'ai posées aux prévenus ce matin. Il me semble pour ma part que la pratique qui avait été retenue par Monsieur le Président était que, pendant leur temps de parole, les parties civiles pouvaient poser des questions aux témoins ou aux prévenus ayant une relation directe avec le témoin, ce qui était en l'occurrence le cas. Alors, les observations de M. le procureur amènent de ma part deux réflexions. Si la réflexion est de dire qu'après l'ensemble des questions, les parties civiles peuvent avoir un nouveau temps, peut-être M. le procureur aussi, pour poser des questions aux prévenus, je pense que ce serait une solution effectivement, je dirais, idéale. Mais si l'interprétation de cette règle privait les parties civiles de la possibilité de poser des questions aux prévenus, je pense pour le coup que ce serait extrêmement restrictif et que je crois que les déclarations unilatérales des uns et des autres qui se succèdent dans le temps Et cette informatique, je pense que de temps en temps, un échange de propos et en l'occurrence pour nous, sur les questions que nous posons, qui sont des questions que nous posons, auxquelles nous devons avoir un point précis, car sinon, les déclarations du prévenu sur les déclarations de la... Les observations du prévenu sur les déclarations du témoin sont un peu une litanie unipersonnelle sur laquelle il ne fait pas des observations, mais sans que nous puissions l'interroger plus précisément. Et on note que parfois, cela apporte des informations qui ne répondent pas précisément à nos préoccupations. Pour ma part, je n'ai pas eu l'impression que c'était une opposition aux articles 80, 10, 91 ou 29. Bien sûr, une solution à laquelle les participants auraient deux temps de possibilité de parole serait bien. Sur ce point, Mme Président, j'en profite pour vous dire que nous avions une discussion informelle en réunion les groupes de participants tout à l'heure, que nous disions que bien nous nous sentions un peu privés dans la possibilité de questions que nous souhaitions évoquer. Nous nous disions que peut-être on pourrait également prévoir, parce que les jours qui viennent avec des auditions très courtes vont donner vraiment un temps minimum, d'ailleurs à toutes les parties, bien évidemment aux parties civiles, nous souhaitons par écrit les questions que nous aurions les uns et les autres aimés poser, que nous n'avons pas eu le temps de poser, pour que vous en jugiez de l'opportunité. Voilà, Mme la Présidente, nous réfléchissons sur ces éléments.
Très bien, Mme la Présidente.
Can I just clarify, Ms. Chacon, you have no objection to the proposal by the international co-prosecutor that the accused be questioned after the defence has put its questions, so long as the civil parties have an opportunity to put questions, preferably with extra time allocated. Is that a fair summary?
Monsieur le Président, si nous pouvons avoir deux temps de parole, un temps de parole au témoin et après un temps de parole à l'accusé, il est évident que ce serait pour nous la solution
idéale.
Thank you. Does the defence wish to comment?
Certainement, Madame le juge. Mon collègue était inquiet de savoir si le témoin pouvait être effrayé. Je crois que c'est plutôt les coprocureurs qui sont effrayés par le contradictoire. La procédure qui a été utilisée ce matin me paraît une procédure qui permet le contradictoire. Et je ne vois pas qui peut être effrayé par le contradictoire. Je ne pense absolument pas, et le témoin l'a prouvé, qu'il était effrayé en quoi que ce soit par l'intervention de l'accusé au moment où l'accusé, et pas le prévenu, Maître Jacquin, au moment où l'accusé est intervenu sur les questions qui lui étaient posées par la partie civile. Je pense que la procédure qui a été utilisée est une procédure, je dirais, interactive, qui permet justement que soient posées en temps utile les questions qui s'imposent. Si maintenant on devait décider de donner à nouveau du temps supplémentaire aux parties civiles et aux procureurs pour réinterroger l'accusé, il faudra alors rouvrir la possibilité aux témoins de répondre. Et on retombe dans les ornières dont nous sommes sortis il y a quelques semaines. Donc je suggère qu'on ne rentre pas à nouveau dans un tel
débat.
Il me semble que, premièrement, on peut autoriser ou les parties civiles ou le procureur à utiliser leur temps pour poser des questions directement à l'accusé et permettre ainsi au témoin qui n'a pas effectivement fini sa déclaration, permettre au témoin de répondre, comme il l'a fait. Il l'a fait. À l'occasion d'une autre question, il a répondu. Et c'est ce que j'appelle un interrogatoire interactif. Donc, pardon, on peut maintenir cette position qui a été adoptée ce matin, permettre à chaque partie d'utiliser son temps pour interroger l'accusé. Par contre, je redis, puisque nous parlons des temps de parole, je redis, je continue à considérer que ne donner à la défense pour poser ses propres questions que le même temps que les parties civiles, sans tenir compte du temps dont a pu disposer le coprocureur, je ne considère pas cette solution actuellement comme satisfaisante. La défense devrait pouvoir profiter du même temps que l'ensemble des parties. Là, nous sommes dans un déséquilibre qui me paraît grave. Et puisque nous sommes également sur ce sujet, je dis que nous gagnerions tous beaucoup de temps et de clarté si les parties civiles pouvaient s'entendre entre elles pour que ce soit chaque fois une équipe qui pose les questions pour l'ensemble des parties et que, à tour de rôle, ce soit une équipe qui pose pour l'ensemble des parties. On gagnerait énormément de temps. Voilà la position de la défense, madame le juge.
Je veux juste dire qu'on ne veut pas une seule personne.
Just one point of clarification, please. Can you give a concrete example of any time when the defense has not had enough time to put its full number of questions to any witness, civil party or the accused for that matter?
Oui, Madame le juge, je peux vous dire que nous éliminons un certain nombre de nos questions. Et je le regrette, pour tenir compte du temps qui nous est imparti. Mais à plusieurs reprises, j'ai éliminé des questions qui étaient prévues. À plusieurs reprises.
Il me semble que jusqu'à présent, avoir relevé que jusqu'à présent, la défense n'avait jamais utilisé entièrement le temps
qui lui était accordé. Donc, vous dites que vous vous réfrénez dans le questionnement que vous souhaiteriez avoir à l'égard de certains témoins. Mais, je ne comprends pas très bien, parce que si vous n'utilisez pas entièrement déjà le temps qui vous est alloué, comment vous pouvez vous dire que vous auriez aimé en avoir plus?
Oui, je peux vous répondre. À partir du moment où je considère qu'une ou deux questions de fond que j'ai à poser va forcément déborder, je préfère ne pas la poser. Et c'est arrivé l'autre jour pour l'interrogatoire de l'accusé lui-même. Et ça s'est reproduit à d'autres reprises. C'est pas la peine que je m'engage dans un questionnement si je sais que je n'irai pas jusqu'au bout. Mais si nous avons plus de temps, je vous assure que nous l'utiliserons, peut-être pas tout le temps, effectivement. Il y a des fois où il n'est pas nécessaire de rajouter des questions. D'autres fois, oui, bien sûr.
Dans ce cas, lorsque à la fin des questions, vous dites, vous, avocat de la défense, nous n'avons pas d'autres questions à poser, il faudrait peut-être être plus clair, parce que ce qui est enregistré sur le transcript, c'est que vous n'avez plus de questions à poser. Et cette précision est, me semble-t-il, pour les juges, une précision entièrement nouvelle. Est-ce que vous en convenez?
Oui, merci, monsieur le juge. J'en prends note. Et effectivement, la prochaine fois, si nécessaire, j'ajouterai, étant donné le temps qui m'est imparti, je n'ai plus de questions à poser. Je rappelle que c'est cette semaine que, alors que je terminais de poser une question, le couperet est tombé et je n'ai même pas eu le temps de dire au revoir aux témoins. Donc, et je me suis plié puisque c'est la décision de la Chambre. Mais si vous le souhaitez, je préciserai chaque fois, la défense aurait eu une question, des questions supplémentaires. D'accord, je le préciserai pour les besoins du procès-verbal.
Je crois qu'il faut pouvoir donner l'opportunité, l'occasion à la Chambre, éventuellement, d'examiner cette requête. Si vous ne le faites pas, c'est que la Chambre considérera qu'elle nécessite aucune requête et que le temps qui vous est accordé vous satisfait.
Précisément, j'avais demandé à nos assistants de préparer une requête écrite pour dire que la défense considérait qu'elle n'avait pas assez de temps. Donc, vous aurez cette requête écrite prochainement.
Peut-être pas nécessaire, je pense.
Alors, on peut, vous pouvez alors, si la Chambre, oui, on peut se dispenser d'une requête écrite et je peux vous indiquer d'ores et déjà que la Chambre, que la défense souhaiterait avoir le même temps que les procureurs et les parties civiles réunis. Voilà quelle est la requête
que je fais. ពីមនុស្សចិត្តតែ 30 មនុស្សហើយដែលយើងរំលោភសិទ្ធសាក់សីដែលអត់បានឲ្យគាត់ត្រឡប់ទៅផ្ទះបំមុនទេដែលថាយើងសង្ឃឹមថាពេលនៅសល់យើងនឹងស្ដាប់សាក់សីបន្តដើម្បីពន្យល់នៃកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីតាមបំណងប្រាថ្នារបស់តំណាងសហប្រជាអន្តរជាតិហើយនឹងមានទវិការពីក្តីមួយចំនួនដែលសុទ្ធតែថ្លែងការលើកឡើងអំពីបំណងនៃការធ្វើសក្ខីកម្មនៃការធ្វើសមណការបានលឿនបំផុត
Thank you, Your Honor. I think that's the problem of having about 20-25 lawyers in a room. Your Honor, in relation to the defense's response, the prosecution's time limit is very short as well, and there needs to be an equality of arms at this trial. The civil parties don't have the responsibility of proving the case. The prosecution does. The prosecution, of course, would like more time to ask questions. The prosecution had a lot more questions to ask, because, as you know, under the rules, the prosecution has the responsibility of proving the case beyond reasonable doubt.
As far as time limits are concerned,
this was an agreement that the defence bought into when we had the trial management meeting. All of the parties said that they wanted the trial to be short, but also ascertain the truth. And to do that, all of the parties have to compromise to a certain extent in relation to time limits. So I find it strange now that the defence are asking for more time, when in the beginning they wanted the trial to be finished a lot more quickly than was envisaged. And one last point, the prosecution encourages the interactivity of the debate. However, it's very, very important that the witness is not sitting in the dock being talked about by all of the parties in cross-examinations of the accused whilst they're in the middle of their testimony. That's very, very undermining of their evidence and the way they would perceive their evidence before this court.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. The President wishes me to indicate that a ruling on this matter will be given probably on Monday orally, but simply we reserve our decision on this point. Now, Ms. Studensky, you had an application also.
Yes, thank you. I have one observation and one application, as I said this afternoon. My observation from this morning is as follows. The four groups of civil parties been allocated each the 20% of our time, and I even could not inform the chamber that I have this book there in the courtroom in front of me, and where I observe if I abide by the time that was allocated to the parties, and I wanted to add, Mr. President, to inform you it is, as far as I see, not we didn't reach the 15 minutes, but it was not possible. While other parties and all parties except the defense exceeded their time this morning, that was the prosecution and the other civil party lawyers, I think, except group would like to ask the chamber at least if this time is so short already, then it is not possible to cut it and to deprive us 20% of our time and without having the opportunity to let the chamber know that this time was not yet reached. That is one observation from this morning, and I checked this time if I want to know. Mr. Kongisay started at 11.
Thank you. I think you've made your point really clearly, and I understand it clearly. Could you move to your application now? Thank you.
The application is the following, and I will explain it very briefly. That all civil party, it happens to civil party lawyers that they could not ask all questions that they wanted to ask and that they prepared in the allocated time. And I would like to make, and that concerns questions to the accused and to witnesses, and I would like to make the following application. To allow us to submit at least the outstanding questions to the chamber and to give the chamber the opportunity at least to ask these questions and to give you one example from the witness Mr. Prak Khan from today, who was asked if he ever saw the accused being involved personally in torture. The witness responded with no, but he was not asked, and he could not be asked because of the lack of time. I have prepared these questions that he could not be asked what is about the kicking against people that he has, according to previous statement, observed, or blows given to prisoners that he came to have observed. And so, as we have learned from the witness, Mr. Van Natt, there is a very different understanding what torture is, and as Mr. Van Natt, when he testified, said that he obviously did not understand kicking, for example, as torture. And therefore, only to give you one brief example, it would be helpful if at least the chamber, if not the parties, get this right, if at least the chamber could take such, I think, important questions to put them to the witnesses, respectively, the accused. And so my application is to give the parties the opportunity, all parties, of course, to submit their questions that are not yet before the chamber to let them know which they find still necessary to ask the witness or the accused. Thank you. This is my application.
Assuming that all civil party lawyers support that application, do the co-prosecutors have any comment submission to make?
Just the mechanics of it, I mean, writing down the questions and giving them to your honours, whether it be in three languages. It may still be better that at the end of the questioning by the defence that the parties actually submit them directly rather than in writing. I think it might actually take less time if they just briefly perhaps announce what the topic is and have your honours decide whether that topic or that particular question is relevant. I think it might be more time consuming if it was in writing, but we support the idea and principle.
Sorry, could I only clarify? Of course, I didn't say it, but I meant to submit this question to make it complete orally, of course, to the chamber and not in writing. Thank you.
Does the defence have any comment?
Madame le juge, c'est une autre manière de poser la même question que celle qui a déjà été posée par un autre groupe de partie civile, c'est-à-dire d'essayer d'avoir du temps supplémentaire à la fin des débats pour recommencer le débat. La défense est totalement opposée au fait que l'on recommence le débat. Et donc, sous réserve de ce que j'ai indiqué tout à l'heure, concernant le temps que la défense réclame sur un principe d'égalité des armes, sous cette réserve, je considère que la procédure qui est utilisée maintenant depuis quelques semaines est précisément la procédure qui nous a permis d'avancer dans ce procès et que nous ne devons pas revenir en arrière. ខ្ញុំចាំលោកស្រីទូតនស្គីនឹងហើយដែលជាអ្នកចង់បានថាធ្វើម៉េចឲ្យវាឆាប់សវនាការនេះទៅបលឿនគាត់ណាអ្នកជំរុញជាងគេហើយលាប់ដល់តែឥឡូវគាត់មកបកើតអារឿងសួមចប់ទៅសេសំណួរណាទៅឲ្យលោកចៅក្រមឲ្យអីណាទៅទៀតតែបកើតឲ្យតែវែងទៅទាំងទៀតអានោះនឹងឆ្នាំណាបានចប់ទេហើយអញ្ចឹងចេះតែចង់ចប់ឲ្យមិនចេះតែបកើតបញ្ហាអញ្ចឹងដូច្នេះខ្ញុំសូមឲ្យតុលាការមេត្តាអនុវត្តតាមវិធានដែលតុលាការបានអនុវត្តកន្លងមកសូមអរគ
Yes, I note, Ms. Studinski, that you wish to take the floor again. As I understand the civil law system, the defence has the final right to speak. Unlike the system I am accustomed to, you get no right of reply, so I'm very sorry.
ឥឡូវនេះយើងដោះស្រាយលើបញ្ហាសំណើសុំរបស់តំណាងសព្រញ្ញាហើយនឹងមេធាវីតំណាងដើមម្ដងរបស់នីក្រុម2ដែលបានពិភាក្សាឆ្លងឆ្លើយគ្នាច្រើនលើកច្រើនតាមទៅហើយឃើញថាដល់ទីបញ្ចប់លទ្ធផលយើងនឹងជម្រាបជូននៅលើកដែលសម្រេចរបស់អង្គជំរះនៅ ថ្ងៃច័ន្ទសប្តាហ៍ក្រោយគឺទី29ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2009ហើយគួរឲ្យស្ដាយដោយសារការកណនីពេលវេលាសម្រាប់ស្ដាប់នៅសំណើស្ដីថ្លែងការណ៍នៅសំណើរបស់តំណាងសព្វវិញ្ញានិងមេធាវីក្រុម 2 ដែលអង្គជំរះបានគ្រោងទុកគឺពេលវេលាត្រឹមតែ10ឬក៏អតិបរមា20មិនុតប៉ុណ្ណោះមិនដែលឥឡូវនេះយើងបានធ្វើស្ទើរតែពេញមួយម៉ោងទៅហើយអញ្ចឹងឃើញថាអ្វីដែលយើងបានគ្រោងថានឹងស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មរបស់សាក្សីក៏ស្រស់បន្តនោះឃើញថាពេលវេលានៅតិចតួចយើងមិនអាចធ្វើការសម្រាប់ការបានទេហើយសូមអភ័យទោសចំពោះសាក្សី កុកត្រោះដែលអង្គជំរះបានមិនបានឲ្យលោកត្រឡប់ទៅលំនៅឋានមុននេះ
chân ông dùm rè bạc cả ạ sạm nạc ca ngày đi trầm đi hơi sạm nạc ca lược từ bần to nờ ngày chăn tìm một hình phân khai cả đá nam bị bọn bầm buôn chạp bình bê lê mong bầm buôn bực hơi mần trái tạc ca tâm bọc tùm rùl chứ mùi nâng ông gặp hiếp con phía xạ xây nạy chùm niên nâng bây về điệp chòm chung nằm nở lúc cậu sở tạ lọp tư lùm nơi than cột vĩnh hơi xông oi nay khang còn pia xạ xây nãy dùm niến chơi như lúc cậu sở một căn xa xạm nạ cá nơi ngày chắn thì một phần bớt khai cả cả đà khẳng mộng đi chập vì vì liền mong bẩm buồn đầm bầy đều bẩn to sẽ đạp tạ khai cam đồ bạc cột anh rẻ mình thì không khang nòm chuẩn đập trao từ căn mình thì không khang vĩnh hơi oi nòm cột một căn xa xạm nạ cá nơi ngày chắn thì một phần bớt khai cả đá chập vì liền mong bẩm buồn bực.